So there's a lot of questions also to be answered around our staff and human resource. We look at what I'm outlining today is based on our current practice with adaptions to current policies, and then looking at modifications, and then looking at communicating some real solid next steps. We know that the more we can communicate with our staff what our processes are, the more they feel they can get access and information and feel comfortable with whatever direction we take. The first thing that has been highlighted in a lot of questions around quarantine due to a positive test, exposure, or symptoms. So our current practice is we have in place our low, medium, and high exposure letters that are on our website to talk about exposure currently in our buildings. The modification that we're recommending, and this is all due to if we can get access to testing and create partnerships, is to look at positive tests, making sure that we have a process in place, which we have already, we have a work in progress, and making sure that we have that in our, on our website, a form that can be completed on our website to report so that it goes directly to our district nurse so she can report that to our health department. And then making sure that employees do stay home when they're sick. And then if you look at the steps and processes on that, making sure that our employees complete that form. We want to make sure we're maintaining our HIPAA laws. So employees shouldn't, they will, we will not be giving any access to that form other than our district health nurse and our human resource department. They would notify their immediate supervisor of their sick through either our ASAP or whatever process employee group, how they notify their supervisors that they're sick. They do not have to tell them they have COVID. We actually recommend that they don't say that. And that, like again, the district nurse would notify the health department. And then we are recommending at this point, we are trying to increase our partnerships to recommend that they have COVID testing before they return so that they can come back to a quicker return. And we would follow the CDC guidelines to do so, so that we can make sure we alleviate any excessive absences if they are tested negative. And then that would prompt the possible completion of an FMLA paperwork. The other topic that is brought up as far as sick time. So the allotment of sick time per employee group, the communication has and will make sure that this is in the front of our communication is we're following our Family First Coronavirus Response Act, which is paid leave to our employees up to 80 hours. If the employee qualifies under the indicators, if they're tested, if they're impacted by this. And for employees who exceed the 80 hours, our group have come up with an idea, and we're looking still to look for recommendations of making sure that our employees are taken care of. We're making sure that we're looking into creating a sick bank to support our to supplement those needs after those 80 hours, which accumulates up to about 14 days. And the process that we would follow is that employees can complete a request to the COVID sick bank if needed. We're working out a process to communicate if this is how we're moving forward. So requests of current employees can contribute to sick bank. It also, we would be creating a committee for this year only, or if need be, an extension for only COVID-related usage of the sick bank, and then the committee would determine, and this committee would be making sure it's representative of all the employee groups, and then the committee would determine the allocation to the employee by request. And like I said, this is a recommendation at this point. I know that as a cabinet team and decision maker. We want to make sure that we are supporting our employee groups to take the time needed. The
Well, just
other piece.
add, and if I can just add to that, I just want to make that clear because I know there's a lot of employees on this as well. So ultimately, regardless of how this all plays out, you will nobody that is mandated to miss school because of any kind of COVID testing or quarantine is going to lose that time or go unpaid for that time. I just think it's important to make that real clear. So we're still working through a number of ways to get there. But that is going to be the end result.
Thank you, Phil. The other, a lot of questions around Family Medical Leave Act. We've already worked on making sure we have our modification to our policies to make sure that they're up to date according to the emergency sick leave. So we have a request form that we're working through to make sure that everyone can access that. And then we're on all of these policies, we are making sure that we're putting together recommendations for modifications that will be added to our handbook, vetted through our legal counsel to make sure that we have that communicated to all of our employees prior to the start of school and sooner than later. The other piece that I want to be mindful of those high-risk employees. We are working through this group and closely with CDC guidelines and health department, making sure that we utilize the ADA process on individual basis, and making sure that we can communicate a very clear process. That's going to be our next step. We know that we have to make sure we communicate clearly so that our staff feel safe in returning to face-to-face. So the process is making sure that the first step is getting medical certification from your doctor. And then also along with the medical certification, we would send an employee with our current district CDC guidelines in regards to the reopening alongside with a job description of that employee. And then that would go into what are some reasonable accommodations. We will use the ADA interactive process to make sure that we're making decisions based on that employee's needs. We have multiple employees in our district, and we have to make sure we have an interactive process. So the outcome will not be the same for all. It will be based on that employee responsibilities, the medical certification and guidelines, and then we'll communicate that out. So I know this is a high-level overview, but wanted to make sure that you understood kind of the questions that we are receiving at this time and that we'll continue to work through and put together modifications in our handbook to go to legal and then to go further for review.